二战后，这两个充满历史恩怨的欧洲大国握手言和。
They were very grateful when France extended its hand for reconciliation, because it was for us also the only way to come back into the international arena and be respected again after some time.
The French admire very much the Germans in the way they have looked at their own history.
面对和解，两国民众又有着怎样的心路历程？专访法德两国驻华大使顾山、柯慕贤。
大家好，欢迎收看《风云对话》，我是曉田。今天的节目录制呢和往常有所不同，因为我们在节目现场请来了两位嘉宾，他们是德国大使柯慕贤先生和法国大使顾山先生。就在昨天，也就是5月9号是欧盟日，所以呢想借此机会请来在欧盟内部不管是经济比重还是政治影响都最有分量的两个国家的大使坐下来和我们一起聊一下大家比较关心的话题，比如欧元区前景、欧盟的起源和发展，以及欧洲的战后和解。好，下面就开始我们今天的风云对话。
1950年5月9日，法国外交部长罗伯特·舒曼提出欧洲煤钢共同体计划。最初，包括德国和法国在内，只有6个国家赞同这项提议，并于1951年成立欧洲煤钢共同体。这是欧洲漫长历史上出现的第一个拥有超国家权限的机构，被人们视作欧盟的前身。60多年后的今天，欧盟已经拥有28个成员国，而德国和法国始终充当着欧洲地区一体化的轴心和火车头。
Good afternoon, gentlemen. Thank you for being with us today. As we're having a special program on Talk with World Leaders, we have two distinguished guests at the same time on the show. Ambassador Claus from Germany and Ambassador Gourdault-Montagne from France. Very warm welcome to both of you.
Thank you very much.
So, 9th of May is the EU Day, a day for the European Union, for the peace and unity of Europe, so as it is described. So I would like to address the first question to Ambassador Gourdault-Montagne. How is EU perceived, really, in your country these days?
EU in our country, in France, is perceived as the great achievement of the after-war period, because when we look back,we consider that we have been at war in Europe every 10 years or almost every year since the Middle Age. And so to have such a period when you are in peace is very important. And not only to be in peace, but to be in peace by the fact that countries have decided that they want to join the project of Europe. So there were some projects of having Europe built up by Charles the Great or by Napoleon or...even, I would say, by Hitler, to build up a sort of Europe. But this was made by compulsion. This Europe of the after-war is a Europe of peace and unity decided by the populations, by the peoples themselves, by the governments, and freely. Between France and Germany, if we look back, for the last 300 years, we have had armed forces along the Rhine River since Louis XIV, and we were making war to each other every 30 years.The last three wars we had in 70 years were the most terrible because they were also world wars. But what the people feel is that we have no longer these armed forces along the Rhine River because we have no more border, actually. And what we have is a Franco-German brigade, which is along the river, and that's a major change and a major achievement.
So that you mean that you can achieve a greater security under the umbrella of EU or the framework of EU. So then I wonder, do you have to trade off some of the national interests so that you can get probably a greater transnational interest? So Ambassador Claus, how do you think of this?
I think that in Europe, inside the European Union, especially between France and Germany, war is inconceivable. It's...since Maurice mentioned that we have the Franco-German Brigade and other structures as well. And we do share the same values, the same political values. We have the same political system, which is democracy. We share also the value of the same market economy structure, same outlook on economy. That is one very important cement holding this all together.
Greece actually now is requesting the war reparation from the Germany for the Nazi occupation as much as 279 billion, if I remember correctly. So how do you think of this request, and how do you think of this very concerning so-called Grexit?
Well, first of all, we believe that the issue of a war reparation has been settled. The German government had taken the responsibility and had acknowledged that it would have to do something about reparations. That was done in the 1960s in relation to Greece, and it was finally confirmed when the Treaty of German Reunification came about in 1990. So from a German point of view, this is definitely settled. The second issue about the Grexit, I think nobody wants to see Greece leave the European Union. And in order to have Greece stay in, France and Germany, but also other member states of the European Union, of the Eurozone especially, did show a lot of solidarity in giving Greece credits, I think something like 200 billion euros, so it could survive. And all of us are ready to continue to do that in case that the Greek government, the new Greek government, continues with the reforms. And that, I think, will be decisive in order to prevent the Grexit that nobody wants.
The Ambassador Gourdault-Montagne, to most of us, both the French and the German nations are two proud nations, so probably in different ways. So I wonder, does it cause any issues when the bilateral relationship was being built up?
We don't think in these terms of being proud nations. Yes, we have a past, we have a history, we have a culture, we have literature, philosophers. We are close to each other. As I said, we share same views, we enrich ourselves from each other. So, and there is a tradition that we know the language of the other. And now Germany is our friend country, and we still learn German. So, and I think in Germany, many Germans did know French and French literature, and they appreciate it. You know, culture was part of each other. That was very important.
Thank you very much for your words, but you didn't answer my questions. So back to you, Ambassador Claus. How would you value or assess the importance of the Franco-German cooperations within the EU?
I think really the Franco-German friendship and cooperation is at the heart of the EU. As my French colleague Maurice Gourdault-Montagne just lined out, French are still the French and the Germans are still the Germans. And we do have, despite all the things that we have in common, being us also inspired by French philosophy, by French literature, by French political thinking, we do also have some differences when it comes to economic issues. For example, when it comes to the independence of the European Central Bank, we are very strict on this. Maybe that there would be a bit more political influence in France. The state has a bit more influence in the economy than in Germany. But that means the views that France is sharing on, for example, economic issues are widely shared by southern European countries. And what Germany believes is the better way shared by northern European countries in general. That means if France and Germany come together and find a consensus, usually that then also is the consensus that will be found in the European Union, and which helps us to progress and to go the way of integration and to solve the problems. What's all the problems of the Eurozone?
We do respect the independence of the central bank, but it's true that we think in certain issues, quantitative easing, for instance, we have had a different approach, which has been decided at the last moment by the head of the central bank, who is the master in his house. But we have discussions, because this is what makes this Franco-German or German-French relationship very alive.
Do you think the strong Franco-German cooperation within the EU is strengthening the EU entirely, or it somehow will need the cost of the benefits of some other, comparatively speaking, small countries?
We need, of course, the others, because as I said, we are not the majority and in the single market either. So, but we are having a way in the whole framework, and we have ideas. And we have ideas also because we are the founding countries, founding member states. We were the two ones who started, even before the EU, pooling together coal and iron, coal and steel. That was crucial because we know that the guns and all the material for the war are made by coal and iron. And as we decided to pool together it was it showed up that we didn't want any longer to make war. Who did that? The Germans and the French. Mm-hmm. So that's very important. We were the ones who started after the war to exchange state town partnerships, twin cities, to exchange people, to know each other better. So we were the Germans and the French who did that.
When France and Germany are close together, sometimes other member states do complain a little bit. But when we are apart from each other and when there's a difference between us, they complain even more because that means there's a stalemate in the European Union, no decisions will be taken, and we just don't progress. Mm. So I think in the end, everybody believes that the Franco-German friendship is beneficial and is the fundament also on which the European Union is based.
How do you think of the current relationship between EU and China? Then how do you think the bond of Germany and France within the EU is influencing the bilateral relationship between China and the EU?
Germany, France are, when you compare to China, you know, size of the population, economic growth and all of that, much too small. And we see that China is in the rise. And that's why we believe that European Union should play a much more important role, because it will be at the same eyes level with China also in future. This is also why France and Germany decided to go together and also to align their China policies with each other in economic fields, but in others as well. And a case in point was 2 weeks ago when Germany and France decided to join the AAIB, the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, the same moment.
You did talk before you reached
yes,
to the agreement.
Yes,
long talks.
Yeah.
从1870年到二战结束后的近百年时间里，欧洲大陆的心脏便跳动于德法这两个处于争斗状态的邻国里。那时他们是彼此的世敌，两国人民间有着根深蒂固的猜疑与仇恨。而在二战后，这两个充满历史恩怨的欧洲大国摒弃前嫌，结成联盟。如今法德结盟平稳地走过半个多世纪，二战后70年的历史也证明，法德的和解对二战后的欧洲产生了极为深刻的影响。
So this year marks the 70th anniversary of the end of the World War II. Earlier this year, German Chancellor Merkel visited Japan, and she replied to the question of how to resolve the issues between Japan and China, Japan and South Korea, by stating that Germany has a look at the history squarely, and that is why Germany is accepted by the international community. So do you think, is it fair to understand this statement as a sort of suggestion to the Japanese Prime Minister to look at the history squarely?
I think there were three things the Chancellor had in mind. The first was, and she made that very clear, that it's not up to her to teach Japan any lessons. Second, she said that for Germany, it was the only possible way to look squarely at its history and to face and accept the responsibility for what it had been doing. And this was the only moral way to do it, and it was also the only way for reconciliation also with our neighbors, with France. So for us it was clear that was also the only way that we would be accepted again in the international community of states. And third element, which somehow was not that much portrayed in the mainland China press, was about reconciliation. If you go for reconciliation, it always takes two to tango, and it was France in the 1950s which did extend its hand towards Germany and to forgive us and to say, oh, we shall be friends in future.
And how did Germany react to the expression by France at the time?
They were extremely grateful, because it was for us also the only way to come back into the international arena and to be respected again after some time. And that is something that we will never forget, the French.
And Ambassador Gourdault-Montagne, I wonder, how does Europe look at the Japanese Prime Minister's visit to Yasukuni Shrine? How can you imagine such kind of similar things happening in Europe?
In Europe, we commemorate and we pay a tribute to the soldiers who lost their life and made sacrifice of their life for their country. That's part of our tradition, that's part of our culture. Then there is the question of the war criminals. And usually we never have war criminals amongst the others because they have been tried, they were before tribunals. Criminal wars are not the ordinary soldiers who lost their life for the country, so it's different.
I wonder, after the war, did the German government really have to make some real efforts to let the German people to look at the war history from a different perspective rather than the one that Hitler regime tried to show them?
It was a difficult and a cumbersome process. At first, it was the Allies, beginning with the denazification, seeing that Democrats would be the founding fathers of the new Federal Republic, which was then founded in 1949. And since then, every German government accepted its historic responsibility for what Hitler and the Nazi regime had been doing. In German society in the 1950s, what had happened during the Nazi era was an absolute taboo issue. And I still hear my mother telling me that when she went to school in the 1950s, history ended in 1933, the year that Hitler took power. And there was no way that they would squarely face history. And it was only with the coming of a new generation in the 1960s that that became an issue in Germany. And people, young people, wanted to know what their parents had been doing in the Nazi era. They had committed crimes, how did they behave, how did they behave towards the Jews and others. And only then a big public debate started in Germany, which even intensified in the 1970s, when movies were shown for the first time on television about the Holocaust. And I remember myself watching an American film about the Holocaust in 1978, and that was seen basically all over Germany. And that the first time they were really confronted with this in such a dramatic and impressive way. And that did change also the German attitude towards the history. And what we have today, Germany is still a proud nation, but I would say it's a kind of enlightened nationalism, knowing all the crimes that the nation or that were committed in the name of the nation decades before.
How did that movie make you think or feel at the time?
Very culprit, and I admit I had to cry when I saw this. You know, it's different if you hear about it in a very abstract way, or if you see a movie about a family which perished in the Holocaust. It touches you personally, it did touch me personally.
Right, and did that change the way you think about the government's teaching during a certain period of time?
With the advent of the new generation, also the school curricula changed, and when I was in school in the 1970s, we did cover also the time between 1933 and 1945. But it was also a different generation of teachers, those who had not participated in the war, who were too young, who were young at that time, had not committed any crimes. So for them it was obviously easier.
Right. Then how about in France? Was it difficult for French people to accept the fact that you are going to make friends again with Germany?
It was not easy, of course, for all the reasons. I remember when I was 18, I had a German friend whom I had known at the university, and so I decided to invite him. I thought I'd invite him at my grandmother's house, and I said, I'm coming with a German friend. She didn't say anything, but she was mute, so I thought she didn't want.
But she didn't poison the food?
No, she didn't poison the food, but I came with a German friend. She was very gentle to him, and it was okay, and afterwards she told me, oh, your German friend is a good guy. But if someone would have told me that I would have a German at my table one day, I would never have believed it. And my grandmother, she was a nurse during the First World War for 4 years, freely, and making the selection between the wounded soldiers who could be have surgery and the others not. And so for her, the Germans would be eternally the enemy. But when I came as the grandson with the German friend, she made up her mind. It was new to her. But for her, it was a total change in all her approach of life. So it was not easy, that's what I mean. It was not easy. The thing is that the French admire very much the Germans in the way they have looked at their own history. We do recognize, we do acknowledge that, yes, the Germans did a lot for that. And we do acknowledge as well that Germany is a great democracy. The Germany of today has nothing to do with the Germany of yesterday, and even less of the day before yesterday. Germany is a new Germany with the Germans who are the most democratic country in the world, in the way the society is open, open-minded. And so it's very impressive to all the neighbors of Germany who have known the Germany of the past, which is no longer there.
Then back to you, Ambassador Claus. How do German people think of the attitudes of the French people towards the wartime history?
I think they were very grateful when France extended its hand for reconciliation, and I think that is still a dominant feeling among Germans. And today, if you look at the public opinion polls, so the highest rate usually for which nation you like best in Germany, that's France.
And the same for the French, looking at their Western allies and friends, Germany is at the top level.
好了，刚才我们看到的是我们和法国大使顾山先生以及德国大使柯慕贤先生的联合采访。此次采访的主题是欧盟的现状及前景，以及法德两国的战后和解。顾山大使他意识到欧盟的存在让欧洲国家避免了战争，而他本人对欧盟前景充满了信心。而柯慕贤大使则是多次借机对法国战后和解意愿的感谢。在今天早前，德国总理默克尔访问日本的时候指出，德国可以公正地看待历史，那也是为什么德国可以被国际社会接受。今年是二战结束70周年，或许本期节目的主题我们可以总结为欧洲的战后反省与和解。感谢收看本期节目，我们下周见。